Good morning, everyone. I'm excited to see that we have a big group again today. We are going to talk about my favorite subject, the Fair Labor Standards Act and the overtime law. And I recognize a lot of the attendees from our earlier webinars where we talked about what the new overtime law is going to be. And we're going to talk a little bit about that. I'm going to go over where they are in the legal challenge to the overtime law, the changes, what I think is going to happen. We're going to talk a little bit about the new DOL secretary and will that mean changes for you as in your workplace. And then I'm going to talk about some positive aspects of what I think came out of this failed or proposed attempt to change the overtime law, because we learned a lot of lessons, and I know a lot of you went through some serious analysis of your workforce in anticipation of the law coming into effect. I want to remind everybody there's a Q&A box, and feel free to ask questions. I'll try to get to as many of them as I can during the webinar, and if not, there's my email, and I'll give it to you at the end. Again, feel free to email me. I will try to get to everybody's questions, if not during the webinar, then after the webinar. And there's also a survey that you can take during the webinar or after the webinar, it'll pop up. And we appreciate when you fill those out because it gives us feedback. And also, we'll ask you about new topics you'd like to hear in our L&E series. So let's get started. Anyone who has been to my webinars before knows that I like to go over the basics of the FLSA, the Fair Labor Standards Act, so we're all talking the same language. And that's been one of the actual positive things that have come out with all the attention that the Fair Labor Standards Act got in the last couple of years, is we started learning the vernacular. We heard exempt and non-exempt, and we heard about what are white-collar exemptions and executive and administrative professionals, all those things that used to just be my nerd lawyer talk was now, you know, part of the conversation as companies were starting to look at their workforce to see if they were in compliance. Also, I know I always get this question and I want to stop myself and answer it before it gets asked. You will get a copy of these slides. They'll be on the Baker Donelson website and they'll also be emailed to you after the presentation is over. So let's start talking about the Fair Labor Standards Act. It was passed in 1938, and it really has two basic requirements. It requires that we have to pay minimum wage for all hours worked, and you have to pay overtime, which is time and a half at the regular rate of pay for all hours worked in excess of 40 hours in a work week. Now, there's also the Equal Pay Act. We've heard a lot about that lately, where similar jobs that are occupied by men and women have to be paid similarly. And there's also a child labor section. But the basic requirements are that the minimum wage and the overtime. And we have to remember it's considered an Employee Protection Act. So employees are generally presumed entitled to overtime. And it has very strict record-keeping requirements. And one of the lessons we've learned, and I'm going to get to, I'm kind of foreshadowing our lessons, is going to be about record-keeping requirements. Because once we have, when the rules were coming out and a lot of people were doing audits, they were realizing that some of their record-keeping requirements were not in compliance with the law. So we're going to talk about what is compliance. Now, even though it has this minimum wage and overtime, there's exemptions. There are certain classification of white-collar workers that do not have to be paid minimum wage and overtime. And what the law says is that, and this is straight from the Fair Labor Standards Act, this language, that someone who is in an executive, administrative, or professional capacity, and then they talk about academic administrative personnel or a teacher, or an outside salesman, and it does say salesman. It was written in 1938, so it doesn't say salesperson, that these groups are not subject to the wage and hour, minimum wage and overtime law. But it's interesting because this little parenthetical at the very end says, as such terms are defined and delimited from time to time by regulations of the Secretary, and that's the Secretary of Labor. So when we talked about when we talk about what happened with the law, it wasn't the act, it wasn't the statute that was changed, it was the regulations. And there's been a lot of news articles lately about President Trump and saying that he's kind of put a halt to the regulations because there was a lot of regulations that were passed in the past 8 to 10 years that became voluminous and have really governed the workplace. And so when we're talking about the law, we're actually talking about these regulations that were enacted by the Secretary of Labor to enforce the law. So when we talk about what and we look at what is necessary for exemption, we're looking at the regulations. So we have two classifications of employees. They're either non-exempt employees, meaning they're eligible for overtime, and we have exempt employees that are ineligible for overtime. So that leaves the question, well, which employees are exempt? What do they need for exemption? And this is all governed by regulation. And it basically comes in three categories. It depends on how they're paid, how much they're paid, and what kind of work they do. So how they're paid is that they have to be paid on a salary basis. So we have a predetermined fixed salary, and we're not going to reduce it because of variations in the quality or quantity of work, and we're not going to take any kind of partial day deductions. And we also, about how much they're paid. We've had a lot of talk about this. Right now, and this is currently the law as it exists today, that to meet this threshold, they just have to be paid $455 a week. So prior to the rule change, this was really never discussed because usually if somebody met the other two requirements, they would meet the second one. And the third one is a job duties test. And we look at what kind of work these people are doing. You know, are they exempt because their primary duty, their principal duty, is exempt work? And it's not a quantitative analysis. It's not like, well, they're spending 80%, although that they look at it. It's more the quality of the work. What is the purpose of this job? So we look at what the purpose of the job is. Now, all three of these have to be met to be exempt, all three of those requirements. Paying a salary alone is not enough. So a lot of times I would have clients call me and say a salaried, that they're talking about a salaried employee, and I would say, well, is it a salaried exempt employee or a salaried non-exempt employee? Because you can have an employee who's paid a salary, but they're still legally entitled to overtime because they do not meet one of the two other requirements for exemption, and it's usually the job duties test. So when there was a proposed rule change, they targeted this second requirement, and everybody thought it was going to be the third requirement, but in May of 2016, the Department of Labor issued their final overtime rule, and it revised the exemption regulations, and they basically took that salary threshold and doubled it, and they took the 40th percentile from the lowest wage-earning region in the census, which was the South. And at the time, that wage was $913 a week. And they increased the salary threshold for highly compensated employees from $100,000 to $134,004. We can't forget the four. $4 were very important, but that was the 90th percentile of all full-time wage earners in the country. And then they also provided for automatic updates that these numbers were going to go up every 3 years. And this law, everybody remembers this, was supposed to take effect on December 1st, 2017. And companies and organizations and universities and cities and anybody who had employees that were subject to the FLSA were scrambling and auditing and making changes to try to come in compliance with this rule. And we're going to talk about deductions. That is actually one of the lessons we learned. I'm getting a couple of questions about deductions, and I'm going to talk about that in detail in a little while. So anyway, we got this rule, and it was challenged kind of at the last minute. We thought it was about to go through, and then right before, you know, in November, two different lawsuits were filed. One was brought by 21 states, and the other was brought by more than 50 business organizations. And I just thought, just for interest, seeing who brought the cases. So this was supposed to go into effect December 1st, 2016, and right before this lawsuit was filed. And in November 22nd, right before Thanksgiving, The district court entered a nationwide preliminary injunction, which basically put a halt to the rule becoming effective on December 1st, preserved the status quo, which meant that the salary threshold did not change until the court could make a final determination on the DOL's authority. And basically what the court said about this was that you really didn't have the authority to make one of the three requirements the determinative requirement, that you had the right as a DOL to make regulations on what was required to be in one of those three exemptions, the executive, administrative, professional exemptions. You can say what the job duties are, but when you made the salary threshold so high, you basically supplanted that became the determining factor of whether somebody made that salary or not, and you made the job duties not as significant. And so that was the basis for the court said that the Department of Labor did not have authority to do what they did. And when the Department of Labor fought back and they filed an appeal. Now, remember, when this appeal was filed on December 1st, ironically, the day that it was supposed to go into effect, this was still Secretary Thomas Perez, who was Secretary of Department of Labor, who was President Obama's appointee, and they wanted this rule to go through, and they disagree with the decision of the court, and they remain confident in the legality of the rule. So they filed an appeal with the Fifth Circuit Court of Appeal. And so that's where it is now. This appeal is still in the Fifth Circuit Court of Appeal. And what can they do? Well, the Fifth Circuit can uphold the preliminary injunction, meaning that the rule does not go into effect. They can actually modify the injunction, or they can reverse it and the rule would go into effect. Now, the question is what's going to happen? You know, this appeal is by the Department of Labor. It is the government that is still supporting this rule, and we have a new administration now. So what's going to happen under the new administration? Well, the new Secretary of Labor hasn't even been confirmed yet, and once the new Secretary of Labor comes in, they could actually withdraw the appeal. And regardless, it's been interesting because a lot of people still feel that the salary threshold is still too low. And would it be possible to, you know, the court basically said that they made it too high because it was becoming a determining factor, but they left it open that there might be a possibility that it could still be increased. So there might be still some changes coming. Now, what happened recently was the Department of Labor requested another extension to file its final brief to allow the incoming leadership, and so the brief is not even due until May. So this was going to give, hopefully, the new secretary some time to make a decision on whether they're going to follow through with this rule or not. Alex Acosta is now the nominee for the Secretary of Labor. Andy Pesner, who was a fast food executive from Carl's and Hardee's, withdrew his nomination, and the confirmation hearing for Mr. Acosta has been postponed twice, but it is this week. It's 9 a.m. On the 22nd, so we're going to see some activity pretty quickly on all of this. He's got a very solid background, and rumor has it that there's not a lot of opposition to him, that he's been described as balanced and an independent thinker. He is pro-free market. He's been confirmed. He's been in other public offices. He's been confirmed three other times, so the belief is that his nomination is going to go through. But the question is with Andy Pesner, he was very outspoken about his positions on minimum wage, on overtime, where we do not know as much about Acosta. You know, his priorities are still, you know, to be determined, and he has not taken a public position on the final overtime rule yet. But the belief is that he's going to look to see whether he believes some of these rules have gone too far, and maybe this was too far reached, too much too soon. So I suspect, this is just my opinion for whatever it's worth, that the proposed overtime rules as they were written previously are dead in the water. I don't believe that they're going to go forward. I do think, however, we're going to see some changes in the overtime rules. How that's going to come about, I think, is really up in the air. We're going to have to see what happens, because the DOL also is having their budget slashed in the proposed budget. So it's going to be interesting to see what will happen when the new secretary gets into place. But I believe it's dead in the water, but I want everybody to, stay abreast of what's going on. We will, if you are not signed up for the Baker Donelson newsletters, I highly recommend you do so. They're free, and we will keep you posted on the latest updates as they come in. And I have all kinds of alerts because I'm always very interested. So with all of this happening and all of, I've dealt with and talked to, I've been across the country talking on this subject and listening to different organizations struggle with trying to come into compliance with the new rules, and some of them went ahead and made the changes anyway, and some of them held off. But one of the great things is that it made us go back and look at our workforce. And one of the things that I wanted to look at is what has come out of all this? What kind of questions, now that we've taken a look, what are we better educated on now that we weren't before? Well, first of all, let's talk about the salary basis. That's our first requirement to get an exemption. I had a lot of questions during when I had clients looking at their workforce about what is a salary basis? Can I take away from their salary? An employee regularly receives a predetermined amount of compensation on a weekly or less frequent basis, even if the salary threshold is based on an annual, they're going to look to make sure you're making the weekly payment. So is it $450? Right now it's $455 a week. They had proposed $913. But the DOL always goes back to a week. They look at a week-by-week basis. And are we making any kind of reductions because of the variations in the quality or quantity of work? And are we paying any week that an exempt employee works any portion of the week? We have to pay the full salary for that week. And there's a few exceptions to that, but we're going to go over these right now. So when can you make a deduction from a salary? So you've got somebody who's getting a set amount of salary each week. When can you make some deductions and not lose that exemption? Because when you make an improper deduction, you can lose an exemption. So we're going to assume that this person is properly classified as an exempt employee. We're going to talk about the job duties test next. So we've got an exempt employee who's properly classified. What can we reduce? Well, first of all, if an employee doesn't work at all during the week, they don't get paid that week. You do not have to pay for any week. Now, if only some work is done, if somebody comes in a half a day on Monday and doesn't work the rest of the week, you can't reduce their pay. They still have to get their salary for the week. That's what being an exempt employee is. Okay. Now, we can also deduct for full day absences for personal reasons. Now, what happens if somebody takes a day and a half off work? You can only deduct from their pay. Now, I'm talking about actually reducing their pay by one day. You cannot do it by a half day, and you can't round up. So if somebody takes a full day, a day and a half of absence for personal reasons, we can deduct for one day. Same thing for sickness, disability, or accident, but we have to have a bona fide sick plan, policy, or practice where they receive compensation. Now, what happens if somebody takes a day and a half off and we have PTO? Well, you can deduct from PTO bank in any way you want. You can deduct in hour increments. You can deduct in half days without somebody losing the exemption. When we're talking about the restrictions here, it's actually reducing pay. So that's when somebody maybe has exhausted their PTO, and then they've taken a day and a half for personal reasons or a full day for sickness. You don't have to pay them for that, but it has to be a full day. So if they work any part of the day, you have to pay them. Now, the other way we can make a deduction is you can penalize someone for a, of violating a safety rule of major significance. Now, this is something I always caution clients about because it depends on how consistent you've been applying the penalties. You have to have an across-the-board rule. We see this a lot of time in manufacturing settings, that if you do this, your pay will be docked for the day. And the Department of Labor lets you do this even for salaried exempt employees without losing the exemption. Now, some other things that they let you do is you can offset, if you've got an exempt employee who is getting money for jury duty or witness fees or military pay and they're missing some work, you can offset their salary by what they've, so if they've taken time off, they've taken a week off for jury duty and they were paid X number of dollars, you can reduce their salary by the amount that they received. Also, they let you, for the first week of work and the last week of work, you can just pay for the time that the employee actually worked. So you can get a proportionate part of the salary for the time worked. So if somebody is terminated or they've quit and they're only working 2 days, you do not have to give them their full salary for that last week of work. You can just pay the proportionate amount that they actually worked. You can also so give somebody an unpaid disciplinary suspension of one or more full days for violations of workplace conduct rule without the employee losing the exemption. You want to make sure this is done under a written policy, though, that is applicable to all employees, that your policy says that you can be suspended without pay for one or more days for a violation of these rules. You can also make deductions for weeks in which an employee takes unpaid FMLA leave. Now, this is when possibly they've already exhausted their paid leave, but they're out for FMLA. You don't have to pay that, and you can actually do it proportionally. So let's say an employee uses 4 hours of FMLA leave in a 40-hour work week. You can deduct 10% of their salary without the employee losing their exemption. Now, one of the things that you have to be very careful about, because if you have a practice that's incorrect and you're making deductions, you will lose the exemption, but not just for that one employee. You will lose it for all the employees in the same job classifications working for the same manager that's responsible for the improper deduction. So you want to make sure when you are making deductions from an exempt employee that they are proper deductions because it has a pretty significant impact. Now, if it's isolated or inadvertent improper deduction, you're not going to lose the exemption, but you have to reimburse the employee timely. So if somebody, you want to have in your policy language that talks about, what happens if you think that there is an improper deduction, who do you report it to, and requiring an employee to affirmatively report that. Also, you want to check with whatever state and local laws that you are operating in because some states have limits or actually prohibitions against certain deductions. So you definitely want to check your state law as well as the federal law. So the second lesson we've learned from this is the job duties test. And if I get any questions, and I've already gotten several even as we're going along today on the job duties, it's, you know, is this person doing exempt work? And we're looking at the primary duty, the purpose of the job. And so the three major exemptions are executive, administrative, or professional. We see it referred to as EAP. For the executive exemption, the primary duty is management of a recognized separate department or subdivision, which includes, you know, interviewing, training, discipline, adjusting pay and work hours, planning and apportioning work among employees, maintaining production or sales records, evaluating, appraising employees. They have to have at least two full-time employees or their equivalent, which can be four part-time employees reporting to them, and that they have to have authority. Now, they do not have to have final authority on hiring and firing and recommendations, but they have to have enough where they are part of the process and that their input is given weight. And one thing I've noticed sometimes I've had issues with people who are counting that they supervise maybe a independent contractor or a subcontractor, that does not count. It has to be an employee or a full-time employee equivalent. The next exemption is the administrative exemption. This is sort of the catch-all, and this is probably the exemption that I see misapplied the most. Everybody likes to kind of use this and say, well, this person is an administrative exemption. This is office or non-manual work that is directly related to management or general business operations of the employer or the employer's customers or client. And this is the big catch-all. Do they have discretion and independent judgment with respect to matters of significance? This person has to be able to make decisions on major items, you know, involving in your operation without having to get approval for it. So, and that includes authority to waive or deviate from policies, to negotiate and bind the company on significant matters, investigate and resolve matters of significance on behalf of management. They're going to be looking at how much authority does this person have and how much input do they have in what the total operation is to come under this exemption. The third exemption is the professional exemption, and there's different categories of professionals. There's the learned professionals, which performance of work requiring an advanced degree. This is lawyers, doctors. You know, it's usually prolonged course, although BA or BS is required. Most of them require some sort of advanced degree beyond a basic college degree. There's also creative professionals. They're working on invention, imagination, originality, talent, music, writing, graphic arts. This is very, very case specific, depending on how much creativity is in the job. Teachers come under professional exemption if their job is teaching, tutoring, instructing, or lecturing. One thing that's interesting with teachers, and there's only a couple of these we're going to talk about, they do not have a salary threshold test. So when the proposed rule came out that was doubling the salary threshold from $455 a week to $913 a week, that did not apply to teachers because teachers do not have to make a certain amount of money to be exempt as teachers. Accountants, somebody asked about accountants. Accountants generally come under, our financial reporting professionals usually come under the learned professional exemption. There are different areas of finance, though, that don't make it, depending on, you know, your basic bookkeeping. There's also a mix, and somebody asked about paralegals. There's also a mix of law on whether paralegals are too. It depends on how much, it's very fact-driven on how much authority, you know, with paralegals, it's usually as an administrative exemption and how much discretion, independent judgment they have. How much work are they doing beyond? And I've had a couple people ask me about, I'm trying to look at the questions too, about accountants. Accountants do generally come under the learned professional. You have to be careful, though, because it depends on what the accountant is doing. If they're doing basic bookkeeping, there's lots of case law out there that says that that is routine and can be considered too routine to come under the exemption. So you'll have to look at what level that they are doing working. Usually HR personnel will come under, if they don't come under the executive, usually HR personnel come under the administrative exemption. So back to our lessons. The other thing I have found, a lot of questions that came about from the analysis after the rule was, are these people even employees? Because the Fair Labor Standards Act does not apply to independent contractors. There's no timekeeping or record keeping or minimum wage requirements for somebody who's properly classified as an independent contractor. However, in the past few years, the Department of Labor has been on a rampage against misclassification of independent contractors, and the courts are also following suit. And what's interesting is this is sort of a bipartisan effort because one of the things that happens with the Department of Labor, I mean, with independent contractors, is that they're not getting taxes taken out of them. And so there's a revenue issue a lot of times for the states. And so there has been sort of this backlash against trying to, what the way it's been categorized is that around organizations trying to get around giving employees their benefits and rights as an employee by making them independent contractors. So we've seen a lot of case law on this. We've seen a lot of DOL audits on this. I don't think this is going to change even under the new administration. I believe that this trend against independent contractors and really cracking down on this is going to continue. I got a question, and that I want to answer. I'm going to go back a little bit, and I apologize for this. I don't usually do this, but I think it's a good question I want to answer. Somebody asked about losing the exemption. What does that mean when you lose the exemption? Well, remember, exempt employees are ineligible for overtime. Non-exempt employees are eligible for overtime. So if you have an employee who is properly classified, they meet that salary threat, you know, the salary basis, we ping them on a salary, we're not taking improper deductions, they meet the salary threshold, which right now is $455 a week, and they meet one of the job duties tests that we just went over, and you take an improper deduction and you lose the exemption, that means that you have to go back and figure out how many hours that employee works and you owe them overtime for it. So that's why you don't want to lose the exemption. And if you haven't kept proper records, they're going to ask the employee how many hours they worked, which a lot of times for an exempt employee, we're not keeping records of the hours because their salary covers all hours worked, right? So that's what I mean when I say lose the exemption. For that period of time, they're treated like a non-exempt employee if you take an improper deduction. So now let's go back to independent contractors. The focus, what the Department of Labor focuses on for independent contractors is what's the economic reality of this relationship? Is this worker really dependent on your organization or company? Are they in business for themselves? And they look at these different factors, and not a single factor is determinative. They kind of balance it, and it's all very fact-specific. But what they're going to look at is how integral is this work to part of your business. And one thing I will tell you is a big red flag for the Department of Labor and for courts is when you have an employee who is doing work who's doing the same work as an independent contractor, and one person is classified as an independent contractor and another one as an employee. That will be a red flag that that independent contractor is misclassified and should be an employee. The other thing that they're going to look at, for, you know, as in terms of that too, is let's say you have an employee, and this is where I see this problem cropping up a lot, is you have an employee, I'll take me for example. I was working and I went out on maternity leave and maybe I came back and I wanted to not work quite the number of hours and I wanted to be an independent contractor just for myself. And I'm doing the same work I was doing prior to my maternity leave when I was an employee. That's also a red flag. If somebody is doing the same work they were doing before as an employee and you're now classifying them as an independent contractor, they will scrutinize that as being a red flag for misclassification. The other thing they're going to look at is how much does the worker's skill affect your profit and loss? And I think that kind of goes with number one, how integral are they to the business? You know, also, what's the worker investing in this versus what you're investing? Are you providing all of the tools, the phones, the internet, the workplace, the paper, you know, or is the independent contractor providing that? You know, does it require a special skill? You know, if we're getting somebody in who's a high-level IT person, we're bringing them in for 6 months to do a project for us, that's probably an independent contractor that has a beginning and an end, and we need their special skills. You know, is it permanent? Is this somebody who's going to work for us for forever or indefinite, and we doesn't have an end date? That's going to look more like an employment relationship. You know, how much control are you exercising over this worker. That's going to be a big factor. You know, are you telling this worker what to do and how to do it or the parameters of it? You know, I always, when I used to do training years ago on independent contractors, I would always liken it to somebody who's coming to paint your house. You're going to tell them what room to paint and you're going to pick the color, but other than that, you're going to leave the painters to do their job as they see fit. And so how much control? Now, if you come in and you say, I want you to use this brush and I want you to go vertical first and then horizontal, and then I want you to do this, this, and this, and here, you know, and you, the more instruction you're giving, the more you're making it an employment relationship. And as I said before, not one factor is dispositive. So if you are treating, if you do have a classification of workers that are independent contractors, really take a look at that. And a contract, an independent contract agreement in and of itself will not protect you. Now, I'm not saying that they're not a good thing to have, but if the person is misclassified, a contract's not going to get you out of that misclassification. So really take a look at if you have anybody who is classified as an independent contractor. The next thing, the next lesson we looked at, and I, you know, when we're talking about a non-exempt employee, and that's an employee who is eligible for overtime, has to be paid minimum wage, one of the big requirements is timekeeping. And we saw a lot of this when, you know, when the salary threshold was going to go up so high and be doubled, a lot of exempt employees who weren't used to keeping track of their time were now going to have to keep track of their time because they were going to be fall out of exemption just because of their salary, and they were now going to be entitled to overtime and have to keep track of their time. And this made a lot of organizations look at their timekeeping method. What are we doing to, you know, to capture the time worked, especially for somebody who maybe works out of their home or somebody who's out in the field? How are we capturing compensable time? Because by law, it is the employer's obligation to make sure the time is kept accurately and that employees are capturing all of their time that is compensable. And so, you know, there was a lot of talk about emailing and calls after work hours, that when somebody is a non-exempt employee, that's compensable time and it has to be captured on some sort of time record and be paid. And so one of the things that's interesting is the regulations on timekeeping say don't dictate that you have to use a time clock or a timesheet or anything. I mean, basically the Department of Labor says as long as they're in their two main words are complete and accurate, you can use any method you want for tracking and recording hours. But if they're inaccurate, if your method is not accurate or subject to challenge, what the Department of Labor does is they ask the employee how many hours they worked, and that's presumed correct, even if they exaggerate their hours, unless you can disprove it. So it really puts you kind of behind the eight ball. You know, and one of the things with timekeeping is we got to be very wary. You know, there was a huge trend in the last 5 years on this off-the-clock work where an employee says, well, I know my time records say this, but they had me clock out and continue to work, which is a violation of the Fair Labor Standards Act and can end up costing a lot of money in terms of back pay. If you're sued for unpaid overtime, you're also or unpaid wages under the Fair Labor Standards Act, they're entitled to liquidated damages, which means they get double whatever you were supposed to pay them initially. So we want to be very wary of off the clock work and have a prohibition against it in your policies. So what basic records do you have to what do you have to under the regulations? What records do you have to maintain? First, you have to have something with the employee's full name and social security number, their address, including their zip code, birth date if they are younger than 19, their sex and occupation. Now, the sex is for purposes of the Equal Pay Act, which I mentioned briefly before, the time and day of the week when the employee's work week begins. Now, you can have any 7-day period as long as you're consistent be a work week. It can be Sunday to Saturday. It can be Monday to Sunday. It can be Tuesday to Monday, whatever it is, but you have to actually have it in writing what that what the work week is. You need a statement of what their regularly hourly rate is, the basis on which their employees' wages are paid, and the nature and amount of each payment. And any time we exclude money from the regular rate, we have to document that, and I'm going to talk about regular rate in about a minute. We also have to show hours worked each day and the total hours worked each week. Their straight time earning, a lot of this is usually on a on your payroll records. It's usually on the pay stubs. Total overtime earnings for the week. Any deductions were taken, we got to show the deductions and the total wages paid each period, including the date of the payment and the pay period that it covered. Now, what happens if we've got an employee who's on a fixed schedule? They work 9 to 5 every single solitary day, and they seldom vary. Can we just have records showing that? Yes. The Department of Labor says you can have a record showing the exact schedule of daily works and only show the exceptions when they didn't follow it. So when a worker is on a job for longer or shorter period of time, we show that exception. This is a risky way, though. I think a lot of times when an employee is challenging their hours. But as long as we're consistent and we have the records, we make the employee sign it, that the exception, and we're consistent with it, it is an acceptable way. It's just a little bit riskier because they're not, if somebody's coming in late, we're really, you know, we have to show the exceptions to make sure we're not looking like we're trying to get around the overtime rules. Sorry, I'm having a little pause here. Okay, so did I miss one? So how long do we have to keep these records? Payroll records, collective bargaining agreement, sale and purchase, we want to keep for 3 years. Anything on which the wage computations are based, such as time cards, piecework tickets, 2 years. And what's the penalties? Well, if you don't keep the record-keeping requirements, they actually have criminal penalties, although I don't believe that they ever enforce them, besides civil actions. And what happens, too, if an employee sues in a wage and hour case, you can't say, well, I don't have sufficient evidence on the hours of work that they're claiming. If they're inaccurate or non-existent, they're going to base their award damages. Courts are going to say, ask the employee, well, what do you remember what you worked? And that's what's going to be the deciding factor on your damages. So you really want to make sure your record keeping is good. This one I'm just going to briefly touch on, but I've sort of alluded to this throughout. One thing, and I kind of preached this all last year when we were talking about the final rule coming into effect and everybody getting ready, is making sure that your policies are up to date and compliant. You know, do we have a policy about off-the-clock work, about meal and rest breaks, you know, depending on state law, travel time, on-call time? Do we have mobile devices? Do we have a curfew about non-exempt employees not using their work emails or making calls after work time, or that we are, you know, keeping track of it. You know, when we record, you know, do we have a record retention policy? Do we have policies regarding letting employees know how we're going to round and do automatic deductions for certain things, about paying for unauthorized overtime? You know, when somebody works overtime, even if it is unauthorized, you're still required to pay for it, but you can have a policy that allows you to discipline for it. You know, and travel time when it is during the working hours is compensable. And so how are we going to keep track of that time and have policies for that as well? So you want to take a look at your policies. You know, and I think a lot of organizations did that. Now, the next thing that I saw come out of the analysis that happened last year with the proposed rule is, are we calculating overtime correctly? And I think I mentioned at the very beginning of the webinar about how everybody's using kind of the correct terms now. We're talking about exemptions and non-exemptions versus just a salaried employee, because remember what I said, a salaried employee can be exempt from overtime or a non-exempt. You can have somebody who's entitled to overtime but is still paid on a salary basis.
The other thing is the regular rate. Overtime is 1.5 times the regular rate, not the hourly rate. And so when we look at the regular rate, we take all the earnings, all remuneration paid to the employee or on behalf of the employee for a week during the week, and we divide it by the number of hours worked. And the overtime premium is based on that rate, the regular rate, not just the hourly rate. So, and that regular rate can't be less than the applicable minimum wage. So, what does this really mean? What's included in regular rate? Well, besides the wages and salary, we're going to look at non-cash wages, goods, boarding, lodging, pay differentials. If we have any kind of shift differentials that they get paid more on for certain shifts, premium pay for hazardous work, any type of bump that they get, that's included in the regular rate. If we give them a bonus, that's included. I get a lot of questions about bonuses. If you pay a bonus, you have to a non-exempt employee, let's say you're paying it either monthly or quarterly, you have to take that bonus and allocate it back. First thing you have to do is, can I determine when the bonus was earned? Is it based on some quantifiable thing that I can look at and say, in this week it was earned, in this week it was earned? In that case, you can allocate it based on how it was earned. Let's say it wasn't. Let's say it's just overall production that over a period of time, over a month or over a quarter. You have to take that bonus and evenly divide it by the number of work weeks and then calculate that number into your regular rate to see if the person is owed additional overtime, because this amount goes into regular rate, which is included in overtime. So if an employee worked overtime 1 week out of a month and then we pay them the overtime that they were owed, but then later in that month they got a bonus, we have to take that amount and divide it by the number of hours worked and give them the premium from that as well. So they'll get an extra check at the end of the month. Commissions are included in regular rate, and any incentive payments that are based on hours worked, productivity, or efficiency. So what's not included in regular rate? Gifts, Christmas bonuses are not included. If we give paid leave, that is not included in regular rate. So if we're calculating the amount that the employees paid for the week, if one of the days is paid leave, that doesn't come into it. And remember, when you're calculating overtime, it's more than 40 hours worked. So if somebody, let's say we've got Memorial Day coming up on Monday, they're getting 8 hours of pay for that. That 8 hours does not, if the employee does not work and takes the day off and gets the 8 hours of pay because of your holiday plan, that 8 hours does not count toward the 40-hour work week. But an employee can still work over 40 hours on the days following a holiday. So that when that happens, we don't count the pay for the holiday. We just look at the time that they actually worked. Reimbursement for expenses, discretionary bonuses are not included in regular rate. Profit-sharing plans, retirement, overtime premium payments, none of this is included in regular rate. So what do? We take the total straight time earnings and we divide it by the total hours worked and we come up with the regular rate. We take half of that, and that is the overtime or the half-time premium. And half-time premium times overtime equals the overtime due. And I'm going to give you some examples to show how this works. So let's say we've got an employee who worked 48 hours this week and their hourly rate is $9 an hour and they received a production bonus of $10. So we're going to take the 48 hours and we're going to multiply it by 9 and we get $432, and we add in the $10 and we get $442. That's the total remuneration that they were paid that week. So this is considered straight time. You'll hear people referring it as straight time. We've paid for all hours work straight time, but now what do we owe them for overtime? Well, we take the total remuneration paid and we divide it by the total hours worked and we get the regular rate. So notice the regular rate is higher than the hourly rate. This is what the overtime is based on. We divide that by 2 or multiply it by 0.5, and we get half of that, which is 461. That's the overtime premium. And then we take that half rate and we multiply it by the number of overtime hours worked. In this case, the employee worked 48 hours, so 8 hours is overtime, and that's the overtime due. So we take the straight time, which was 442, we add that overtime, and that employee is owed $458.88. So let's do another one. This is one where we've got an employee who is working two different jobs. Okay, so the employee is working 21 hours at one rate and 26 hours at another rate. And this employee works 7 hours of overtime. Well, which rate do we use? Well, we have to figure the regular rate. So we multiply the first rate by the number of hours worked, and then we multiply the second rate by the number of hours worked, and we get the total remuneration for the week. That's the straight time. We divide that total amount by the total hours worked, which is 47 this week, and they get the regular rate, and then they multiply that by 0.5, that's the overtime premium, and then they multiply it by 7 because that's the number of overtime hours that this employee worked, and we get the overtime, and so we take that straight time, the 412.50, and we add the overtime, and we get the total amount that the employee is owed for the week. Yes, so somebody asked about the regular rate. The regular rate will fluctuate based on the number of overtime hours worked. Now, you only have to calculate the regular rate when the employee is working overtime. Now, if your bonuses are paid, somebody asked if the bonuses are paid semi-annually, do you have to recalculate it? If the bonuses are paid to non-exempt employees, you have to go back for whatever period of time that bonus covers, and you have to allocate it through that 6 months time period and then give them any additional amount that they would be owed, you'll find that it's usually not very much. But you would have to go back and pay them overtime in addition to the semi-annual bonus. Somebody asked if it's shift differentials would go into regular rate, so you would add that in as well when you're calculating the regular rate. So the next lesson, and I got a lot of questions about this, was inside versus outside sales. And this is one of those weird things in the law that I can't really explain. It came about a long time ago when there used to be door-to-door vacuum sales people, and I don't know if they just had a good lobby or what. But inside sales are non-exempt, meaning they are entitled to overtime, and outside sales are exempt. Why there is this differentiation today in 2017, I do not know and cannot explain, but it is still the law. So there is no salary threshold requirement for outside sales. So when they talked about the proposed rule that was going to bump everybody to $913 an hour in order to qualify for the exemption, this did not apply to outside sales. So what do you need to be an outside salesperson? Two things. One, your primary duty is making sales or obtaining orders or contracts for services or for the use of facilities. Now, I know there have been some efforts by some organizations to push marketing people in this because they're making sales. The Department of Labor has rejected that. I don't think there's a lot of case law on it yet, but the way that the Department of Labor looks at it is that this is the person who's actually in charge of making sales, obtaining orders, or some sort of contract, that they're not just strictly marketing your business. So if you have somebody who's marketing and then another salesperson that comes in, that's going to probably be a difficult argument to make that they come under this exemption. And they have to be customarily and regularly engaged away from the place of business in performing that duty of sale. So it cannot be somebody who is making sales by internet or by telephone. And the Department of Labor has specifically said that outside sales does not include sales made by mail, telephone, or internet unless such contact is used as an adjunct to a personal visit. So you've gone, you're meeting with these, your clients or customers, you're making a sale, and then you're following up with, through internet or through email or calls, that it's incidental. Also, the Department of Labor has addressed, the employee that does sales from home, the telecommuting employee. And what the Department of Labor has said is any fixed site, even if it's your home or if it's at an office, if it's used by the salesperson as headquarters or for purposes of making calls for sales, it's considered the employer's place of business. And so even if the employer does not in any formally sense own or they're not a tenant of the property, you're working from home and you're making sales, if you do not leave your home, that's considered the employer's place of business. And remember the requirement, they have to be customarily and regularly doing these sales away from their employer's business. It is also considered to be away from the business. They have to be outside, doing it outside of their home. So inside sales, there is no salary threshold. Inside sales are non-exempt, meaning, now remember, a salary threshold is just for exemption. That's just for the employees that are not, you know, do not have to be paid overtime. And they have a salary basis. We're paying them on a salary. They have a salary threshold, a certain level they have to meet. Right now it's $455, and then they have a job duties, which for outside sales is that they're conducting sales outside. So if there is an inside salesperson, if somebody's making sales by phone, that is a non-exempt position. You have to keep track of their hours, and they are entitled to overtime. If they're making commissions, that commission goes into the calculation of regular rate when you're paying them overtime. Somebody asked a great question. Do I think the Department of Labor will update the job duties to be more in aligned with today's workforce? I hope so. You know, that was always my hope, that when President Obama had asked for changes, you know, that was what everybody was expecting, was that the job duties was where we were going to see changes, and then we didn't. You know, they ended up doing it on the salary. I still think down the road we're going to see some adjustments, hopefully, and some streamlining of the job duties test. It's gotten very, very vague and very case-specific, and also dependent on the courts and how the courts are interpreting it. So that's always difficult for an employer. So my final lesson, and I always find this kind of interesting on what employers and employees, because I'll have clients sometimes call me and say, well, my employee says that they're entitled to this, and I'll say, no, they're not. So what is not required by the Fair Labor Standards Act, which is the federal wage and hour law? Well, first of all, meal breaks and rest periods are not required by the federal law. Now, a lot of states have that requirement, but there is no federal requirement for that. Also, there's no requirement that an employee be paid extra money for working on the weekend. It's not due to that. The only time an employee is legally entitled under federal law to get extra money is when they work in excess of 40 hours in a 7-day work week. So there's no actual, you know, coming in on Saturday or Sunday, you don't have to pay more unless they're in overtime hours. Also, there's no federal requirement for raises. The only requirements are for a non-exempt employee is that they make minimum wage, and for an exempt employee that they meet the salary threshold, which is $455 a week right now. There is no federal requirement for vacation, holiday, severance, or sick pay. That is an agreement between you and your employee of whether you're going to give that. You just want to make sure your attendance records reflect adjusted time accurately when you're using paid leave. Show when you're using paid leave versus when it's compensable time. Also, this is one I get a lot. You do not need an employee's consent for them to work overtime. The Fair Labor Standards Act does not require notice or consent for overtime. You have, as an employer, have the discretion to establish work schedules as long as you're paying the employee properly and wage and overtime hours are observed. You do not have to get employees' consent or give them prior notice. Now, if, you know, a lot of policies say that overtime has to be approved in advance, but you have to remember this. If an employee works overtime, you have to pay it even if you didn't authorize it. You can punish them. You can discipline them. You can terminate them, but you still have to pay anything you knew or should have known about if somebody is working overtime, even if it's unauthorized or in violation of your policy. So on my final word on this, you know, the new overtime rule is facing an uphill battle. It's possible that it will survive in some form. We're just going to have to wait and see. I think a lot of it's going to depend on the new Secretary Acosta, assuming he gets confirmed this week, which I think he will. We're going to, I believe it'll be a top item because of the timing and everything. We're going to hear pretty soon what's going to happen with that law. But we want to proceed with caution, you know, monitor the status of this litigation, be on the lookout for changes, and really take, this is a good time now to take a look at your workforce and to do that auditing that was happening in the frenzy of trying to get into compliance by December 1st of last year. You know, I think now we've got a little bit of time, not a ton, but this is a good time to kind of take a look at your policies, take a look at your payroll records, your calculations. Are we doing this correctly? And it's a good time to fix it. And I will stick around for a little while and answer some questions. But for everybody else, thank you for being here. And I know a couple people had some sound issues, and I'm sorry, but it will be recorded and on our website. So if you need to go back and look, feel free to do so. So I'm gonna stick around and answer a couple questions. You know, if somebody asked about equal pay, I think a lot of companies in their audits, when they're looking at their workforce, they're addressing equal pay. That is something that you really don't want to have to address once an employee brings it up, because usually when an employee brings it up, it's in a lawsuit. So when you're doing an analysis of your workforce and looking at the different pay and how you're paying them and are these people exempt, it is good to look at job classifications and look at your female versus your male employees and say, do we have some issues in terms of, you know, is it disproportionate? Are the men getting more raises? Is there, you know, does it not pass the smell test, so to speak? So it's definitely something I would recommend looking at as well. Let me see if another. Now, this is interesting. Somebody asked, and this is a great question, what if you have someone who does both inside and outside sales? This is going to go for any exemption. They're going to look at what's the primary duty, and I know that's easier said than done, but if the person is out more than they're in, then they'll probably be okay to be considered an exempt employee under outside sales, and the inside sales will be incident to the outside sales. If it is pretty even, more than likely, as I said at the very beginning, the Fair Labor Standards Act is considered an Employee Protection Act, and so it is likely that they will find that the employee is non-exempt and entitled to overtime as an inside salesperson. So it really is very fact specific. You'll have to look at how much time and what the purpose of the job is and how often are they going out and seeing customers and conducting sales outside of the workplace. Yes, somebody asked about an annual bonus. If you were paid an annual bonus for a non-exempt employee and it is a non-discretionary bonus, based on production or overall work performance or some sort of defined measure, you do have to go back and recalculate for the entire year of for any week that was worked over that. And you just have to do it for the weeks that were overtime. But you divide it by 52 if you can't figure, you know, if it's not something quantifiable where you can identify when the bonus was earned, you divide by the number of weeks in the year, and then you go back and look at the overtime weeks that were earned overtime, and the employee is owed additional overtime. I think we've got a couple of questions that sort of are in that vein about the bonuses. So I think I've answered pretty much all the questions. Thank you, everyone, for sticking around, and please join us on future webinars. Thanks.